November of 2012, teachers across the Farmington Public Schools District in Michigan were encouraged to compete for a series of $1,000 grants being awarded by the BOSCH Corporation to educators teaching energy, science, and technology. 15 grants were awarded to teachers in the district. Among them, Rachel Torres, a second grade teacher reviving an environmental learning program previously lost to budget cuts. Linda Valise, a high school teacher purchasing programmable robots. And Roxanne Meekum for helping her students turn an abandoned parking lot into a garden to feed the starving of Detroit. This is their story.
It was an early morning commitment, but all of them, I mean, early morning and you've got your hands in dirt and seeds, it's easy to stay awake.
Robert and Wendy, maybe we should let Gabby want to push it and guide you.
We've got 16 people.
Hopefully it helps to keep the community fed, especially those that are less fortunate. They can't keep themselves fed quite as easily.
I've met some really good friends who are very interested in doing what we can to make the world a better place.
Detroit and Flint have undergone the greatest non-war, non-natural disaster population loss in the history of the planet. If you've never turned right off of Woodward into Highland Park, like you did that day, you have no idea the level of destruction. The stuff that you guys are planting today is going to a raised bed garden on a 30,000 square foot parking lot in Highland Park on Glendale. We call that the Glendale Gardens. And it's right across the street from a homeless shelter for veterans. And all the stuff we grow will grow right to their soup kitchens. And whatever we have left over goes to the community.
I think for this exact purpose.
13.
What was the genesis of the idea, the money to make it happen, any of that? Where did it start?
Okay. I had the idea that I really wanted students to think more about where their food is coming from. And then I was reading in the newspaper about Detroit and how they don't have access to fresh produce, and I hadn't really thought about that before. It was a few years ago that I had read that, and kind of bothered me. And so I started looking into community gardens and urban gardens and what the Detroit was doing with urban gardens. So I combined the ideas together and decided I wanted my kids to learn how to grow a garden here, or to grow food here, and then somehow use what they're learning to benefit the people in Detroit. So I was reading through some email from the district, and there was BOSCH was offering $1,000 grants to teachers who had ideas that dealt with technology, sciences, or the environment. And I thought, wow, I think this applies. So I looked through the applications and went through the process and applied for a grant for an urban garden. And got the grant, so here we are.
I'm into gardening in general, so that's kind of why I got involved with this. Okay. This one is on
camera. I'm Roxanne Meekum. I'm a bilingual para here at Farmington High School. And I also am the advisor for the Interact Club. It's a community service club. It's sponsored by the local Rotary. So I organize monthly community service projects for the students.
Hi,
Chris Gellinger from Buckets of Rain. He's a horticulturist, and his specialty was gardens or gardening in places that are really hard to garden in. He travels to Guatemala, Africa, and he helps those people grow vegetable gardens. And he wants to come to Detroit. So I found his number and gave him a call and said, hey, we're a school club, Interact in Farmington High School, not far from Detroit, and we'd like to help you. And then I told him, hey, we have a greenhouse that doesn't get used at Farmington High School. So I offered that up to him, and he was very excited.
In addition to the urban garden, Roxanne plans to use some of her seedlings to start a courtyard garden for use in partnership with the other classes at the school.
I've got the yoga class, they want to be involved. The yoga teacher loves this kind of thing, so she wants to be involved. The foods teacher wants to be involved. APES, the AP environmental class, is involved with the composting and some other things. So yeah, there are a number of classes that are excited.
These are obviously not the same.
It's a hydroponic system, an ebb and flow hydroponic system. This is rock wool. It's like made from volcanic whatever, but it's a nice medium to grow, has a lot of nutrients to grow seeds. So we'll just get water running through it, pulling from the bucket, running through it back into the bucket, and we'll put the nutrients right into the water and see how the hydroponic seeds grow compared to our other seeds and soil.
Yeah, definitely a rewarding experience. We know how much of an impact this is going to make.
We want clean air to breathe. We want clean water to drink. But good, healthy food, fresh food, I think is just also a right, basic right. The process that the next step, the next stages will be keeping these seeds alive. Our greenhouse is old. There are a couple leaks. It doesn't function 100%, but if weather will cooperate, we get some good sunny days, I think it should be okay. Within probably 6 or 7 weeks, we hope to be able to, that all these seeds sprout and germinate and sprout, and that we get some growth that we can see. And then we'll sigh or give a sigh of relief that, okay, we haven't killed the seeds. And then once things that the plants are ready to go outside, then we've got to take all of these plants down to these gardens and plant them in the gardens downtown. I'm hoping in May we'll have our big planting day in Detroit.
The urban garden seeds are entering their early spring growing period, and it will be some time until they are ready for transport to Detroit. But before that day arrives, another grant project is being initiated at Farmington High School, and this one is far from the garden.
My name is Linda Valise. I teach a variety of classes. I'm a business teacher and a career and tech ed teacher. Okay, the story of the robots and the BOSCH grant is this. Last summer, I went to a course at Michigan State. It was called the Tapestry Workshop. It was sponsored by the National Science Foundation, and it was for teachers of programming. And I had suggested that we revive the class at Farmington High because I think that computer programming is just so important. And while I was there, somebody brought up the fact that they utilize the Finch robots. And of course, I was picturing a man that was made out of tin that would walk around. I didn't know what a Finch robot was. So I was really excited to get them. And then I thought, well, yes, I might have to go get a second job. And then, magically, probably a month or so after I got back, I heard about grants. When I opened the email and I found out that I received one of the grants, I was like kind of like yelling in my classroom. The teacher next door came over and said, is everything okay here? And I was hoping to get 2, but I was able to buy 10 for our classroom.
Mrs. Valise came up to me one day in class and just handed me a box and said, "Hey, I think you'd be interested in this." So we opened it up and there was a little robot inside. So we took it over to a computer and just started hacking away at it. The first time we got it to move, we weren't expecting it to do anything, and all of a sudden, motors just start whirring, and all of us were just, "Whoa, what just happened?" It was exciting. We can make it change colors, we can make it move around the floor, and detect obstacles and change its path based on those detections. We can make it balance on a book, so we turn the book back and forth and the finch stays on there using its acceleration.
It does seem to have a personality.
My name is Finch.
The kids that work with them, depending on what they do with the programming, the robot's going to respond in different ways depending on what the student chooses to program into it. And you can make it almost be sassy, or you can make it be very kind of stodgy and obedient, like a little pet. I should market those.
I am really smart.
The robot isn't smart. The kids have to be smart because the robot does exactly what you tell them to do.
How smart are you?
I can tell you anything you want to know.
And that's always entertaining when a student might tell the robot to do something and forget to tell it to stop. So the learning is just happening because if the robot doesn't stop and they're sitting there going, "Wait, why is it doing that? It won't stop. Did you tell it to?"
I'm going into computer science personally, so just the ability to interact with the robot and see what I can do with it, put code into a computer and see what comes out of it is just really cool for me.
Can you tell me what my career will be?
Yes.
Okay, what is it?
You will become a professional programmer.
The learning just goes off the charts. So there's no test, but you can see those kids just doing phenomenal things. That's where the real learning is taking place. It's pretty neat to see.
The whole classroom changed. You get to work with an object that, like, it can talk to you, it can move around. Instead of just putting codes in the computer and see, like, how it works, you actually get to, like, see the movement.
In art, you know, you draw something and then you look at it and it's there. In this, you create something and then the robot just kind of takes on a mind of its own.
Kids talk, and when they say, "Oh, this was an amazing class," you'll get the next year, you'll get more interest from students. The grants are available to any staff member at any grade level. So if you're teaching the little people, God bless you. If you're teaching the little people and you have a great idea that would be something that you could pull into your classroom, you should apply for a BOSCH grant next year. As I'm going to.
Thank you, BOSCH, very much.
Thank you, BOSCH.
Now in late spring, Miss Meekum's seedlings have been growing for several weeks.
The plants grew to actually quite large sizes in very short amounts of time.
The project has been going on for a while now, and we've been watering the plants and watching them grow. And actually, pretty recently, quite a few of them have been taken away to be used at the project area itself.
Chris Gellinger from Buckets of Rain has been returning to Farmington High to transport the now maturing plants to their new urban garden home, located in the Highland Park section of Detroit. Today, he is at the school to retrieve the final portion of the crop.
Detroit and Flint are, between them, have 66,000 vacant lots. They've undergone massive population loss since the auto industry went into decline. And that's left behind a lot of underserved communities that we hope that community gardening can rebuild, both through the positive aspect of food and again removing blight. We love these little high school greenhouses. They're magnificent growing structures. They provide the right environment. Buckets of Rain supplies the trays and the soil and the seed, and the high school kids do the watering and do the the maintenance on the plants. And once our little seedlings come up out of the ground, it's like having babies. We're parents now, and we have to take care of their every need, and they did a spectacular job. When the plants get to be a certain age, then they're ready to be moved out. They're ready to get in the ground and get on with their lives.
There are some plants that we were wondering if they were growing at first, and there are some that just didn't show in the end. But I think mostly it was a pretty successful mission.
Hopefully it helps to keep the community fed, especially those that are less fortunate. They can't keep themselves fed quite as easily.
Every one of our high schools that have gone through the 10 to 12 week process of growing seedlings have had a little separation anxiety when the plants finally do leave. But it all pays off when everything's ripe and ready to be picked and taken into the soup kitchens. That's what it's all about. Our biggest enemy in getting from the environment of the greenhouse totally protected out into the real world is the transport, really. We have to preferably make sure we've got to keep them out of the wind, we've got to keep them out of the sun for a couple of days. So when we get to the garden, it's not uncommon for them to spend 24 to 48 hours in the shade and in the gentle wind to kind of finish up their acclimation process between greenhouse and real world. I'm out of the wind.
Although the last plants are arriving in Detroit, they're doing so without Roxanne Meekum, who has experienced a return of the cancer for which she has been undergoing treatment. Roxanne continues to anxiously monitor the garden's progress from home. Now both she and the seedlings struggle for life.
I know that if she was feeling well, she'd definitely be here with us, and I feel like it's really hard for her to just know that she can't be here and help us as much as she'd love to. We're all really hoping that she can get better soon.
Used to be a district-sponsored field trip. We would come out here every year. The second graders would do some great experiments. But about 5 years ago, because of budget cuts, it was no longer a field trip for second graders. One thing we've always talked about is how great it would be to bring this field trip back. But when I heard about BOSCH Corporation giving away grants for anything related to ecology or technology, I immediately thought of this field trip. My name is Rachel Torres. I am a second grade teacher at Wood Creek Elementary School in Farmington Hills, Michigan. Today we have second graders out here for an ecology field experience. We're at Shiawassee Park, and we are here on a field trip. Some of the things they were looking for were the amount of students that would be impacted, how many students would benefit from the grant. We have four classrooms here today. Each one, it's probably about 75 students, all of them second graders. And then after I thought about it, actually this field trip can keep on going because the materials are not something that's consumable.
Use your eyes, use your ears to notice everything that's going on so we can go back to the classroom and have some really good discussions, have some really good information.
The students are going to be collecting water and soil samples. They're looking to see the colors, the texture, what's in there, using different properties that they've learned in science. They're going to be going down and actually scooping some of the water to see if it's cloudy, if it's clear, if there's anything that they see floating inside of it. When we go back to the school, we have purchased microscopes, and so the students will get to look even further into it and see if they see anything that they've never seen before through a microscope.
Okay.
And kids like to get their hands dirty, and they're definitely, when they're picking up those soil samples, and they like to get their hands wet. And so when they're doing that, they're pretty happy, and that makes me happy, seeing them happy.
That's okay. That's a good thing.
So this station is the water width of the river. Students are getting a rope connected over the bridge to measure it in yards, inches, and feet.
Is measuring the current of the river, and so we start off with an orange on one end, 50 feet where the dam starts, and then 50 feet down on the bank there are students standing there with nets. There's another student with a stopwatch, and they're measuring two times the current of the river, the speed at which it's traveling.
We dropped the eyes in the pond, and we saw how fast it was with a timer to catch.
Yeah. There are certain things in the classroom, even with all the resources we have, whether it's computers, videotape, microscope, even all the hands-on things, it's not the same as being out here and actually seeing a chrysalis attached to a leaf, as opposed to seeing it in a book or seeing it on a video. With more and more budget cuts coming our ways at all times, it's good to know that there are people out there that want to help out.
This is the Detroit Rescue Mission Buckets of Rain Garden. At 211 Glendale. We are in Highland Park.
It's our home at last.
I got a call from a good friend of hers saying that Roxanne wanted us to talk to each other. She said, call Roxanne, send her pictures. She's intensely interested, wants to stay up on the progress of the gardens. And she said she has 5 or 6 weeks to live.
After the school year was over, we were quite shocked how quickly she declined and was gone. She not only worked with the students here at the building, she also helped them in their outside world. I went into her office just to find information on the grant she had gotten, and this stack of files, it was so high. I mean, these are just all the folders of everything that, the programs that she has, so. So many that I didn't know about. She did the recycling, she did the gardens, she worked with UNICEF, she did a Relay for Life, she took a group of students down south to help with the recovery, the relief from the hurricane. There are so many people that have stepped up and said, whatever we can do to make sure that everything or anything that she started doesn't go away.
I've always had teachers that I get along with, but Miss Meekum is a lot more than that. She's less like a teacher, she's almost like family.
Everything that Miss Meekum has started is lasting on and can really change our community for the better. It's a legacy that could last as long as the school is here.
She was a remarkable woman. She will be missed.
Roxanne wore a bandana like this every time I saw her. I think it was the same color, might even be the same tie-dye, and that's why I'm wearing it today, as the ultimate show of her support and love for urban agriculture. She has made Buckets of Rain the in lieu of flowers beneficiary of her for her survivors. So we get a few checks in the mail every day. Every time I pull in, I just get out of my truck and I go, wow. This is already a gigantic urban garden. Just look at this thing and how it's growing. This is for her. An eye-opening experience for me, and I've been around the world I've worked in some scary places. This is one of the saddest, but at the same time, it's one of the most hopeful because we're starting from scratch. If we were to give out trophies for good work, as in the good work that the kids at Farmington High have done, the trophy would probably be this tomato plant right here, which, you know, if it weren't for those guys, this plant would not be here. And it's covered with flowers, and it's got all kinds of tomatoes getting ready to go. That's our thanks to them. And we look forward to doing it again next year.
It seems crazy that we have starving people in Detroit. My biggest hope is that it's the whole process is it, that someone loves and cares for this process, the whole process, even beyond where we can be as involved as we'd like to be.
Website, bucketsofrain.org, and there are addresses there to that you can mail a donation to. We're a public charity. Everything you do is tax deductible, and we send you a notice for that, and you can make a little note on it if it's in honor of someone or in memory of someone.